Let us worship God. Praise ye the Lord. Unto him sing a new song, and his praise in the assembly of the saints. In sweet psalms do we raise. Let us join our voices in singing the words of Psalm 149. The tune is Bishop Thorpe, number 34, but the words are those of Psalm 149, the first five verses, singing to the praise and glory of our God this psalm. Let us continue our service and worship of the Lord as we together, unitedly, corporately, bow before him in prayer. Let us stand for prayer. Whom have we in heaven but thee? There is none upon earth that we desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart fail, but thou, O Lord, art the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Thou art the Prince of Peace. Thou art complete and entire peace, and you bring peace when you come. Come, we pray, and bring with you that peace that passes all understanding. O our Father, we do pray that this would be a great day of righteousness and of peace, of truth and of holiness. Come with your grace and with your peace. Bring peace into our hearts through the Lord Jesus Christ, who has made peace by the blood of his everlasting covenant, and brings peace wherever he goes, and we pray that he would bring it to our hearts this very day. Father, we do thank you also that there is not only peace for us as individuals, there is that peace that fills our homes and brings concord and righteousness and rest into the family. Father, we are grateful for those virtues that have come with our Lord Jesus Christ that make for a home that is peaceful, for a family where peace reigns. And Father, we pray also for the peace of the Church of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are thankful for that church, and we are grateful that you continue to rule and reign in it. And we do ask that this would be a great day of harmony within the Church of our Lord Jesus Christ and unity. Father, we know that it is easy to disrupt the unity of the church, and Satan is always working to do that very thing, seeking to deceive us, to persuade us, to show us that he is able to do a very evil, incendiary, even sometimes a raging fire for disunity. We pray that this would not be that kind of a day within the Church of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we would esteem others better than ourselves. Father, we are grateful that there is in Christ the rule and the reign of our Lord Jesus, and he brings that peace as the Prince of Peace into the church. May he do that very thing today and upon the General Assembly that is already met, and upon all the courts of the church, as they will from time to time be meeting. We pray that this congregation would find themselves with a unity, with a concord, with a peace that passes their understanding. Father, we know that the wicked do not love peace, and they make war even when they say they're for peace. May you keep down their machinations and give no success to their efforts to sow that discord. Father, we also pray that there would be peace in the nation over which you govern. We do not know why we would pray that, for there is much reason for there to be a lack of peace. But we pray that there would be in this nation, in these United States, at least a relative peace, that there might not prevail what we deserve, and you would not bestow upon us the thing that we have reaped and the harvest that we have sown. We pray, O Father, that there would be, despite the wickedness and perverseness of this nation, a measure of peace given. And we pray that for the president to be a man of peace, though he is really a man of war. We pray that you would overrule that he might be a man of peace. We pray this for the legislature of our United States and the Senate. We do not understand how men can be so wrong and do such wicked things. Father, we are perverse and we are perverted, and we pray that you would overrule and you would govern this land in righteousness and truth again, to a measure that would at least be acceptable and not bring upon us the just condemnation that we can reap for our sins. We pray for the justices of this land and the judges that you would rule there, for there is much havoc through the courts. They have made havoc and not just and righteous judgments. We pray, O Father, that they would cease to try and be the lawmakers of the land, they would give themselves over not to activism, but to the rulings and passings of judgment upon the laws that are enacted by the legislature. But being, O Father, we ask, unwilling sometimes to make just and righteous laws, we cannot rejoice when the judicial branch of our government makes those laws or seeks to make them, though it is an illegal action that they are performing. We pray, O Father, that you would give to this land just and righteous laws once more. Though they have never been perfect, we are grateful that they once were, to some measure, just and equitable. And we pray that would be true again and not into the confusion and the unrighteousness that comes with unjust and inequitable and false laws into this land. We pray for that peace to come among the nations, among, O Father, all the nations of the earth. There would be peace, and it would prevail. And yet we know there will be wars and rumors of wars, and there are today wars and rumors of wars, and we have made them quite often. We've contributed to it, even us as citizens of these United States. We do pray for the gospel to go forth in great measure and great power through your Holy Spirit and the preaching of the truth. We pray for your truth to go in such measure as would be, surpass our expectations, our even dreams. Father, we know you're able to do far more exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, for your mighty power is beyond anything human. It is the divine power that we seek, not human. And we pray for that power to be bestowed upon the church, that it might preach the truth in the power of your Spirit. Pour it out upon your congregation this day, in this place, and upon the one who serves you. We pray, O Father, that you would not give us what we might deserve, for we have not, any of us, given ourselves over to truth and to righteousness fully and entirely. Sometimes, O Father, we have mistaken what is true, and sometimes we have done the wicked, and we have sinned against you, and we have in thought, word, and deed transgressed. We pray you would be merciful and govern and give to us the prevailing righteousness that will bring great success to the gospel. Father, we are grateful that this day is a day of rejoicing, a day of honoring, a day of blessing, a day of success in your kingdom. And we pray for it to come in the home, in the family, in the marriages of this particular congregation, that marriage would be held in honor by all. Father, we do ask this for your great glory as well as for the good of your people. And we pray, O Father, that you would show us truth and righteousness, that we might follow it all the days of our life and not walk in the ways of the wicked, nor in the ways of transgressors. When we reap to our own chagrin, great havoc upon ourselves. Sometimes we have driven out peace by our sin. We pray that true peace would come when the Lord Jesus Christ powerfully rules as the Lord of his church and over his kingdom. May the King come, and may he rule and reign in every one of us. And there would be, therefore, a quality and a quantity that would astound us in the way of gospel peace. Father, we are grateful that you and your grace have overruled and have many times forgiven and have shown us more mercy than we ever could have thought of deserving. Father, we know that no man shall be justified in your sight except you are a pardoning, gracious, loving Father in heaven. And we call upon you as our Father, that you would overrule and bring the wonderful blessings of the home again in every part of your kingdom. Father, we do ask this day that you would be with the pastor of this congregation, that you would oversee, even while he sleeps, if he is asleep, and you would rule and reign in his heart and in his life and in the ministry you've given him in those places where he is venturing to give a witness to the truth. May it be a mighty witness, a powerful witness, all to your great glory, we ask it. May you do your work in many places wherever your gospel is proclaimed throughout this land. And Father, we are grateful that you are pleased to do so, taking the truth, even when sometimes imperfectly given, and showing your kindness, your loving and fatherly compassion to your people. So may you rule and reign in every place where your truth is preached. Father, we do pray that you would turn us, therefore, again, and let us be saved through your great mercy. Show us your salvation, which is only through the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and bring many, even of the children, and well as adults of this congregation, into the fold, into the kingdom, that they might rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. And all to your great glory we ask it, in Jesus' name, amen. Turning again in our book of Psalms, we're singing to Psalm 51, verses 7 through 13. The tune is a new tune. It's Bedford number 31. We will be looking to sing that tune through in just a moment. But let us take the words of Psalm 51 from verse 7 through 13. Cast me not away from thy sight, nor take thy Holy Spirit away. Restore me thy salvation's joy. With thy free spirit stay. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be turned unto thee. Singing number 51, 7 through 13, the tune Bedford number 31, a new tune.
Oh,
Turning now in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 2, let us continue to serve the Lord and worship him as we read his holy word. May you give it your most reverent attention. It is the very word of God. In the second chapter of the book of Genesis, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which the Lord created and made. These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created in the day that the Lord made the earth and the heavens. And every plant of the field before it was of the earth, was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground. But there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord to grow every tree that is pleasant in to the sight and good for food. And the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And the tree went, and the river went out of Eden, and the river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from thence it was parted and became into four heads. The name of the first was Pison, that is which compasseth the whole land of Havilah. And there was gold, and the gold of the land was good. And there was Delium and the onyx stone, and the name of the second river was Gihon. Same is that which compasseth the whole land of Ethiopia. And the name of the third river was Hiddekel, that is that which goeth toward the east of Assyria. And the fourth river was Euphrates. And the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou mayest not eat of it. For in the day thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. And the Lord God said, it is good that the man should not be alone. It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make a helpmeet for him. And out of the ground the Lord formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam and to see what he would call them. And whatever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all the cattle, to the fowls of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, now, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and the woman, and were not ashamed. Let us sing again to the praise of God from Psalm 51, verses 14 through 19. The tune is I won't get that right exactly. Number 25. And the words, however, are those of Psalm 51, the verses 1 through 17. I will show forth my name to generations all. Excuse me, I'm sorry. A broken spirit is to God a pleasing sacrifice, a broken and a contrite heart. Lord, thou wilt not despise. Singing to the glory of God, to his praise. Psalm 51, beginning at verse 14 through the end.
Shall I trust in God?
Let us turn again to God's word as it's found in Hebrews, reading the 13th chapter of this book of Hebrews. Reading the 13th chapter of Hebrews. Let brotherly love continue. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Remember them which are in bonds, as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity, as being yourselves also in the body. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have, for he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. So that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man can do unto me. Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. Be not carried away with divers and strange doctrines, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace, not with meats which have not profited them that have been occupied therein. We have an altar whereof they have no right to eat which serve the tabernacle, for the bodies of the beasts whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin, are burned without the camp. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without the gate. Let us go forth, therefore, unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. Here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. This is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks in his name. But to do good and to communicate, forget not, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give an account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. Pray for us, for we trust we have a good conscience in all things, willing to live honestly. I beseech you the rather to do this, that I may be restored to you the sooner. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation, for I have written a letter unto you in a few words. Know ye that our brother Timothy is set at liberty, with whom, if he come shortly, I will see you. Salute them that have the rule over you and all the saints. They of Italy salute you. Grace be with you all. Amen. The section of scripture that we're looking into is under the general heading of brotherly love. Several verses do come under this heading, and there are many, at least some, I guess I should say, maybe it's not universal, but many who say that this verse comes under that heading of brotherly love. Now, marriage in the New Testament day was violated by Jew and Gentile. Was not held in honor. A Jewish man could divorce his wife for almost any reason if he wished to do so. if she displeased him, he said. Maybe she put too much salt. Maybe she spoke against his mother. But whatever displeased him was liable to bring divorce. And the Gentile world was worse. Women were treated like chattel. They were treated like property. Men did anything for pleasure, including temple prostitution. And the women, they began to rebel, as they've done today. They would not bear children, lest they should lose their figure. Abortion was rampant. And the women began to develop themselves in ways that would surprise you, perhaps, that women could develop themselves, except that we see it today in our land. Women were wrestlers. They took up the sword, struck against their husbands. Juvenal says that women began to lord it over husbands and left home to flit about from one marriage to another. Something about that sounds very familiar, doesn't it? We see a very similar state in our nation today. And the church has helped to cheapen marriage, not honor it, by the way in which they have allowed divorce and consented to it in this land. That perhaps was the very beginning of the cheapening of our marriages. A sad thing. But nevertheless, we have contributed. And the world gets worse and worse. And licentious behavior and abortion and woman's liberation and really bondage, woman's bondage, I should say, not their liberation, but their bondage is everywhere to be seen in this land. But as it was with the Jews, there develops another sort of what would we call reaction. And the result was that there developed in the Jewish religion a view that you should not marry. That the physical part of marriage was to be looked upon as evil, not as holy. And therefore, you could be more holy if you abstained from marriage. Should I give you a reference to that in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 3, I believe it is. Let's see. Maybe I'll go to verse 1. 1 Timothy, chapter 4. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly in the same that in the latter times some shall depart from faith, giving heed to the seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry. There it is. They began to forbid marriage, commanding people not to marry, and commanding to abstain from meats which God had created to be received with thanksgiving in them which believe and know the truth. And every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer. But no, they did not hold to this truth that all things are holy. They abstained from marriage and forbid people to marry. So the false way had gone full cycle. You get a reaction against when you become licentious, and people begin to take another false tact, another heresy is thrown into the mix. Well, let me give you the sermon outline, and I do it with some trepidation, for this is a great subject, much greater than I. In fact, I do tremble sometime whenever I preach the Word of God, for there is much to be given to the people of God that can be profitable, but if we do not give it as we should, we might make them to stumble. May you not stumble over what I would say today. May it be as clear as I can make it and as cogent as I can present it. We are all, is the first point, we are all to hold marriage in honor and the bed as undefiled. Second point, yet God will hold us all accountable for every sexual sin. We will all be held accountable for every sexual sin. We're all to hold marriage in honor. We will all be held accountable if we sin. We have, first of all, a declaration or an imperative. It means a command. I'm not sure which it is, but I think it's probably an imperative. But it could be a declaration. But whatever it is, there is something very dramatic. Marriage is honorable in all. Some have translated, let us hold marriage as honorable in all. Now, why is there marriage? Why don't we just cohabitate like animals? Because God created us not as the animals, but as man and woman in the very image of God himself. We are made in the image of God. We are not beasts. Now, who is to marry? God instituted marriage at the very beginning for the first man and the first woman. He instituted marriage for them. Did we not read it in Genesis chapter 2? So man and woman have this institution from the very beginning laid out before them. From one man and one woman forever. Now, why? What purpose is there? What is the reason for it, or the end of it? So let us think about the purpose of God, because it is fourfold. We need to give it a little more thought. First of all, there's procreation. Secondly, prevention of temptation to sin. Third, a preventative against disease. And lastly, the provision for the welfare and good of one another, the husband and the wife. So, the purpose of God is manifold. For at least, I could say it's fourfold, maybe greater than this. I don't pretend to have exhausted, perhaps, his purpose. But certainly one of the reasons is there might be an offspring to bring children into the world, to propagate the race. Procreation, we call it. Then there's preventative against the temptation to sexual promiscuity, to sexual sins. Prevents us from launching by our own will into wrong relationships. Marriage is a protection against this, a preventative for it. Then there's a preventative against rampant diseases, sexual diseases, transmitted by the act of sex. And there are many, and they seem to get worse, not better. And then there's that provision for the welfare of one another, for each other, husbands and wives and children as well. So children are taken care of, wives are taken care of, and husbands are looked after, so it provides this helpmeet for one another. And God took man from the side of woman, not that he should rule over her or be ruled by her, but that he might be beside her and bring children also to pass. Now, why is there marriage? Well, let's think a little more about it. Christ has made marriage honorable by his attending upon a marriage. It was the first miracle he ever worked. turning water into wine at the marriage. So this shows that God himself and his Son, Jesus Christ, incarnate God, held it in highest honor or esteem. He would attend on a wedding, not ignore it. And why is it honorable? How do we show its honor? Because it reflects more fully the image of God, the image of God as triune. Now, how does it do this? Well, we have the husband, the wife, and the children, if God is willing to give them. And this reflects a triunity, a trinity. So we begin to see how we can see the honor and the grandeur and the worth of marriage. But who may one marry? No, what is marriage? I need to cover that first, because I didn't mean to skip over that. What is marriage? Well, marriage is a covenant, a creation ordinance. And all human beings may marry, but it's for one woman and one man, and they're to be married, one another, till death do us part. Let me read some words that are very fitting, I think, even though it may not be the ceremony that your church uses, it's something similar to this. There is this institution of marriage, the solemnization of marriage in these vows that we take. And it begins with these words, "Dearly beloved, we are assembled here in the presence of God to join this man and this woman in holy marriage." Holy marriage. "It is instituted by God, regulated by his commandments, blessed by our Lord Jesus Christ, to be held in honor," there's the phrase from Hebrews chapter 13, "to be held in honor among all men. Let us therefore reverently remember that God has established and sanctified marriage for the welfare and happiness of mankind. Our Savior has declared that a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife," not only at the beginning, but Jesus repeated it when he was on the earth. "By his apostles, he has instructed those who enter into this relation to cherish a mutual esteem and love, to bear with each other's infirmities and weaknesses, to comfort each other in sickness, trouble, and sorrow, in honesty and industry, to provide for each other and for their household, children, in temporal things, to pray for, spiritual things as well, to pray for and encourage each other in the things which pertain to God, and to live together as the heirs of the grace of life." Good bit of coverage. Yes, very important. So we begin to see how this is for the benefit and the welfare of all concerned, husbands and wives and their children. And it is a union, a covenant, if you please, a union, something that keeps together one man and one woman, and until death do part them. And they're to hold one another in a mutual respect and esteem and honor. The vows that are often taken are these: "I, blank, take thee, blank, to be my wedded wife, and I do promise and covenant before God and these witnesses to be thy loving and faithful husband in plenty and in want, in joy and in sorrow, in sickness and in health, as long as we both shall live." Solemn, wonderful, blessed, and honorable. But who is it that may marry? Well, marriage is a creation, I say, ordinance, and therefore every human being may marry, with these exceptions. Not any closer of kin than God allows in his word. Leviticus 18 and verses 6 and following. There's the exception, or at least one exception. Let it be with one who will be a help and not a hindrance. A help, not a hindrance. Let the wife be that. Let the husband be that also, in one sense. Cannot be one of another. Of the same sex. Never. That was never thought of. Never considered. It is an abomination that man should be with man or woman with woman. Cannot be. God does not allow it. It is not a marriage. It is an abomination. However, Christians may only marry others. We have one more exception for Christians alone. The other is for all mankind. Christians may marry only in the Lord to believers, not to unbelievers, not anyone outside of Christ, but only those who are in Christ. And so I'm going to tell you something today. Don't ever date an unbeliever. Don't ever date anyone outside of Christ. Never. Nor are you to ever date a Roman Catholic. An infidel, and other idolaters. I'll give you what our confession says. It's very plain. Therefore, such as profess the true Reformed faith should not marry with infidels, papists, Roman Catholics, or idolaters. Neither should such as are godly be unequally yoked by marrying with such as are notoriously wicked in their life or maintain damnable heresies. So there are exceptions, and they must be kept. And if you don't date these folk, you will never marry these folk. They never heard of dating in New Testament days. People were given to marriage, but they should never be given in marriage to an unbeliever. And that includes papists, infidels, and others who are idolaters. Well, how may we hold marriage in honor? What would we do if we hold marriage in honor and hold the bed to be undefiled? Or as one translation has put it, pure. It's not the best translation, but it may say something. Hold the bed as pure. Well, first of all, by chastity. That is, by understanding and teaching and practicing sex only within the bounds of a proper marriage and never outside of marriage. Never outside of marriage. The bed is defiled unless it is in the marriage, a marriage bed. That is undefiled and pure. But let me tell you how it is not to be held in honor. Not by celibacy. That is abstaining. Celibacy is abstaining from marriage at all. This only encourages the use of marriage that will contribute to sin. Instead of it being a protection against sin, if we practice celibacy, that is living and abstaining from the physical desires that God has given us, we only exacerbate and enhance the sinful behavior of people who cannot curb their sinful desires. So that's why marriage was given, at least among the reasons why it was given, that they should not sin by fornicating, nor by committing adultery either. Within the bonds of marriage, we do not honor marriage by giving ourselves to celibacy. There was a great Southern Presbyterian who said, marriage is the great pillar of morality. William S. Plummer. Marriage, the great pillar of morality. Marriage keeps us pure, holy, satisfied in this area, without sin. Well, at least we should not sin. We can sin with our minds and our hearts, even when we keep our marriage vows pure and unbroken. And we want to talk a little bit about that in the future. Who is to hold this in honor, marriage in honor? Everyone is to do this. Those who are married, those who are unmarried, the old and the young. It is honorable in all, and it is undefiled for all marriage is. No, there is no marriage that is perfect, not absolutely, not when we think how great sin is and how many times we succumb to it. And yet marriage is an honorable estate, a condition that is blessed by God. Sexual immorality breaks out where marriage is not held in honor. And we must not encourage such. So, having exalted this holy and undefiled estate condition of marriage, the writer turns to the unholy and defiling sins of the flesh. So we look at the 13th chapter and the 4th verse. Marriage is honorable in all and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. God will hold men accountable for their sexual sins. Let me stop a moment and think with you a bit. We have to think about this. Now, God gave laws, commandments. Are they meant to restrict us? Are they meant to inhibit us? Are they meant to, what we call it, put us down? Are they meant to make us unhappy? No. God gave laws that are righteous and just for our good, that we might learn from them how we, as those created in the image of God, should live. Think about it for a minute. This law not to commit adultery, one of the commandments, one of the 10, was not made to take away our fun. It was made to protect our wives, our mothers, our daughters, other relatives, other friends. Suppose everybody kept all the 10 commandments all the time. What kind of world would it be? A friend of mine said he had a little kid sitting on the front row. And when he asked that question, the kid said, oh, that'd be like heaven. She spoke out. Sometimes kids are like that. And it would, wouldn't it? It would be like heaven if everyone kept the whole of God's law all the time and kept it perfectly. We'd have heaven on earth. So God didn't give this commandment out of spite for us, but for our good. And he will judge all who sin in the ways and fleshly ways that are to be condemned and that he has condemned. And what are these sins? Well, there is fornication and uncleanness and immorality. Should I read it to you? Well, I guess I should, maybe. I don't want to read too. I could read many places because these places are numerous in Scripture, but I'll read only one from 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 18. Flee fornication. Simple. Flee fornication. It's telling us don't ever do it. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. Within yourself, you sin when you commit this sin. So the word fornication appears from many contexts to include every sexual sin outside of marriage, whereas adultery includes all sexual sins within marriage, when you're married already. So this fornication or uncleanness condemns polygamy. I think that's the next thing that's coming to this nation. I may not be a correct prophet. I don't claim to be a prognosticator of the future, but I would say it's probably likely that polygamy will be next sin in this land. We've already agreed, at least legally in this land, that perversion, this wicked abomination, is legal. And the next may be polygamy. But we are not to sin by committing adultery either within the marriage. So we read in Matthew chapter 5, verse 28, some very significant words, and I could elaborate upon them. Time will not permit me to do so, but I will touch on it quickly. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery already with her in his heart. So if we sin when we're married by unfaithfulness to our wives, that is a terrible, terrible sin against ourselves, but against our wife. Not just against ourselves, but against another and our children. But it is a sin also of the heart. And we must remember all of this is from the heart that men go astray. And you can have thoughts that are sinful when you have not done the act that is sinful, when you've not sinned by committing adultery. You can commit adultery, nevertheless, in your heart, when you look on a woman to lust after her. Now, I don't think it's wrong to admire women, but it is wrong to lust, to covet, to desire them as your own. All those who do these sins are going to be held accountable by God. Every one of them. Today, there is no shame, it seems. Have you seen anybody blush lately? Very rarely. Maybe you do if you're living close to the church. Nobody blushes anymore. There is no sense of guilt. Certainly they don't admit that it is guilt, that they're guilty. They would deny and do it openly that sin of adultery or fornication is wrong. We can do whatever we want to do. We're free. After all, what I desire is what I should do. God gave me these desires, they might say to you. So he made me this way. Why shouldn't I use them the way I wish? Because God has forbidden such sins and will hold accountable everyone who commits them. Even when I have this drive within me, yes, they must be kept in bounds, the true bounds of Christian freedom. You see, it's all about freedom, isn't it? I think it is. This is what the Christian life is all about, being free. But there are boundaries, limits, so that we don't hurt one another. Even my father, being a lawyer, could say, "Your liberty ends where my nose begins." Didn't say it often, but he said it several times. Are we free to go punching people in the nose? Of course not. There are limits, boundaries to our freedom. We all know this, even if we deny it. And so it is wrong, never right, to commit adultery or fornication. But we live in a relative age. We have absolute relativism. There is nothing absolute today but relativism. Everything is relative. And if you want to make people mad, then give them another absolute. You'll probably be, some of you, mad today. If I've given you these absolutes, it doesn't make you happy. It makes you furious. I hope it doesn't, but I think it might with some. Because the only absolute is relativism. Everything is relative. It's what I want to do. What satisfies me. What makes me happy. What makes me a person who enjoys myself any way I want. Fun seekers. But with respect to God, all who do these things shall be judged. Whatever they think or what others think, God considers it worthy of his judgment. He will judge the fornicator. He will judge the adulterer. He will judge those who live in a perverted way. Look at Romans chapter 1. You'll see that very plainly. But what judgment? How will God judge? In two ways. He may give present retribution, or he may give future retribution. Now, present retribution could swiftly follow. The punishment could take many forms. I cannot cover them all. John Calvin, in his commentary 500 years ago, wrote, "I think the apostle is here contrasting marriage with fornication as a remedy." I think that the apostle is here contrasting marriage with fornication as a remedy against disease. So it's a remedy against our being judged with diseases. And it's bigger than that. But sometimes it comes very quickly, swiftly, judgment, because we have sinned, because we have violated the commandment of God. And I think it true. Maybe you don't, but I do. And marriage is the cure for these dreaded diseases that are put upon us by our God in judgment. Now, I'm not saying it's always tit for tat. There are people who get caught up in it who've never sinned because their husbands have sinned, because their wives have sinned, because another has sinned. And they are the reapers of their sin. The consequences are heaped upon them. But abstinence outside of marriage is the only sure way to avoid these diseases by both partners. But future retribution will also come if it doesn't come in the present, now, here and now. There will be certainly upon the impenitent sinner by God a judgment passed. Will come at death. The wicked shall be cast into hell, and all those that forget God. I say that with great sadness, because it is a sad thing that they shall be suffering such consequences of their unrepentant sin. They've been reserved in chains unto the resurrection sometimes and the final judgment. But it comes at death when they are reserved for the final judgment at the great resurrection, the general resurrection. But it will come, if not at death, at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, these are kind of overlapping, so there will be a general resurrection of the dead, and the final judgment will be rendered, and a sentence will be passed, and the eternal punishment will then be enacted and inflicted. Should I read it to you? Maybe. Matthew 25 and verse 48, and these shall go away into everlasting punishment, the righteous unto eternal life. And there are many other places that this might be pointed out, that we might learn about the judgment and the consequences of our sin. God will weigh the hearts and the desires, as well as the words and the works and the actions of men. Every heart's desire will be weighed. The only remedy is to come to the Lord Jesus Christ in faith and to turn to Him, children, adults. Listen, there is accountability. God is certainly going to judge, if not in the present, which He sometimes does, then in the future, which He surely will. He has said it, it is so. He keeps His word. It will be as He has said. But let me say this. Such sins are not the unpardonable sin. No. Those who repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ will find themselves healed, forgiven. Every one of us needs to repent. Have we not, every one of us, at some moment, I don't know when, you've broken these commandments in heart, in thought. If you haven't done it in deed and word. So we all need to repent and to believe, to humble ourselves before the Lord. We've all come short of the glory of God. There's the standard. Not your standard, nor my standard, nor any other standard of man. It is God's glory. His righteous law is the standard. So let us come humbly, penitently, begging for mercy, crying out that God be merciful to me, the sinner. And there is mercy for all who come in Christ, who come in faith and repentance to Christ. He is the Redeemer and the only Redeemer. And the Redeemer of the world, the only Redeemer of the world, anyone in the world can look to, is Jesus Christ. So let us come to Christ and to no other. There is no other. Don't you go around trusting Mary or any of the saints and all this abomination men do of their idolatry with. Come to Christ and Him alone. Look no more on a woman to lust after her. Look in faith to Christ and be saved. Be saved. Live with your own wife with all contentment. Marriage is honorable in all. Let us stand for prayers. Father, we come to the only God of heaven and earth and our God, the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we acknowledge marriage is honorable. It is a marvelous, blessed, significant institution given to us by God Himself, not only to reflect the image of God, the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but to show forth the praises of our God in wonderful ways that nothing else mirrors them and pictures them. And so we pray for there to be good marriages, honorable marriages. May they who are married recognize their responsibility not to deprive their wife of themselves and not to deprive their husbands of themselves, unless it be for a short period of time, for some special reason, significant reason, but not forever. So may they live together as husband and wife in the holy bond of matrimony. And may you be pleased to give to many children, a family. So we pray, O Father, that you would show forth your praises, your glory in this honorable estate of matrimony. In Jesus' name we make our prayers. Amen. You may be seated. Let us sing to the glory of God. Psalm is 115. Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but to thy name be the glory. Let us sing verses 1 or 12. Excuse me, I'm looking at the wrong stanzas. Number 12 through 18, close of the chapter. But the tune is Talus. The tune is Talus, number 138. The words are those of 115, beginning at verse 12 through the end. Let us stand together for God's benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with you all. Amen.